गुड मॉर्निंग। टुडेज टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज एचआईवी ऑपर्चुनिस्टिक इन्फेक्शंस एंड मैनेजमेंट। एचआईवी वायरस वंस इट एंटर्स द बॉडी वी हैव सर्टेन स्टेजेस। फर्स्ट स्टेज इज प्राइमरी इन्फेक्शन एंड मोस्ट ऑफ द पेशेंट्स मोर देन 50% द डायग्नोसिस इज मिस्ड because mostly they present with flu-like symptoms. The incubation period for this HIV virus is 2 to 4 weeks, and patient presents with flu-like symptoms, fever, headache, myalgias, arthralgias, maculopapular rash, pharyngitis, lymphadenopathy, and some mucosal ulcerations. The duration of these symptoms is variable. It can be up to 2 weeks. But diagnosis is missed as the symptoms are very non-specific. During this stage of primary infection, there can be transient lymphopenia, decrease in CD4 counts. So patient can present with mild opportunistic infections like oropharyngeal candidiasis, but not major opportunistic infections. At this stage, early diagnosis can be made by detecting HIV RNA by PCR. Seroconversion takes around 2 to 12 weeks after development of symptoms. After this primary infection, the viremia drops and the immune response develops, and it reaches a plateau about 3 months later. Next is the asymptomatic stage, which is a prolonged period of clinical latency. In this stage, patient will not show much symptoms. He'll be just having some persistent generalized lymphadenopathy with nodes typically less than 2 centimeters in diameter. This asymptomatic phase can last for several years. It can last up to 8 to 10 years. And before developing this full-blown AIDS, patient can have minor HIV-associated disorders due to impairment of cellular immunity. And patient can present with oral candidiasis or oral hairy leukoplakia or other opportunistic, minor opportunistic infections. And treatment should be initiated now irrespective of CD4 count. After a median period of about 9 years from infection, patient develops full-blown AIDS, that is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. AIDS is defined by the development of specified opportunistic infections, cancers, and severe manifestations of virus itself. CD4 count drops below 200. Normal CD4 count is 800 to 1200 cells per cubic millimeter. In AIDS, counts drop below 200. Almost all systems in the body can be affected by HIV. And CD4 count, by measuring this, we can arrive to certain differential diagnosis. CD4 count is useful in differential diagnosis of various opportunistic infections that may present at higher CD4 counts become increasingly common as counts decline. So the counts rule out certain disorders. TB is the most common cause of morbidity and mortality in HIV individuals. So it should be considered as a DD in most presenting problems, especially if the patient is from low socioeconomic areas. CD4 count and the risk of HIV associated diseases. If the count drops below 500, then diseases like tuberculosis, bacterial pneumonias, zoster, oropharyngeal candidiasis, Kaposi's sarcoma, all this can be seen. If the count drops below 200, then PCP pneumonia, chronic herpes, ulcers, esophageal candidiasis, and chronic diarrhea, HIV wasting syndrome, HIV associated dementias can manifest. When CD4 count drops below 100, then cerebral toxoplasmosis, cryptococcal meningitis, cryptosporidiosis, primary CNS lymphomas and cytomegalovirus infections and MAC infections occur. So in nutshell, at least you should remember these 4. If the count drops below 500, TB manifests. Below 200, then patient can present with PCP pneumonia. below 100, AIDS patient can present with seizures due to cerebral toxoplasmosis, which is the most common cause of seizures in AIDS individuals in final stages. And if it's less than 50, then blindness occurs due to CMV retinitis. AIDS patient can present with lymphadenopathy either due to infections or malignancies like lymphomas and Kaposi's sarcomas. But TB should be always considered if there's lymphadenopathy, especially in low and middle income countries. Tuberculous lymph nodes are multiple, matted, and they can be fluctuant due to extensive caseous necrosis. Weight loss is one of the major manifestation in AIDS patient. This is called HIV wasting syndrome. There will be weight loss of more than 10% of the body weight, plus unexplained diarrhea, plus chronic weakness and unexplained prolonged fever for more than 1 month. This weight loss is due to reduced food intake and chronic inflammatory condition. Reduced food intake can be due to painful oral ulcerations and also nausea due to ART drugs which the patient is using. And depression is very common in these AIDS patients, and this can cause significant weight loss. Fever, these patients present with prolonged history of fever and they can present as pyrexia of unknown origin. Coming to manifestations in AIDS patients, they can present with several mucocutaneous diseases and differential diagnosis of the skin conditions by lesion type. They can present with scaly rashes or pruritic papules or papules and nodules, blisters, mucocutaneous ulcers and hyperpigmentation. Seborrheic dermatitis is a very common skin manifestation in AIDS patients. As the CD4 count drops, fungal infections play a major role in the pathogenesis of this condition. Patients present with red scaly patches over the trunk and the extremities, and treatment, they respond well to antifungals and also steroids. If there is scalp involvement, you can go for shampoos consisting of selenium sulfide. Herpes simplex infections, once the counts drop below 200, patients present with recurrent episodes of herpes simplex infections. Patient present with ulcers or fluid-filled vesicles over the nasolabial folds and also anogenital areas. These fluid-filled vesicles, they rupture to form the ulcers, and these ulcers, they heal, but recurrence is very common. And if the ulcers are persisting for more than 1 month, then this is AIDS-defining condition. Diagnosis of this herpes simplex infection is usually clinical, but PCR can be done from the vesicle fluid or the ulcer swabs. They respond well to antivirals, acyclovir. This is the image of AIDS patient showing severe mucocutaneous herpes simplex ulcers over the buttock region. Zoster infections, herpes zoster, pathognomically vesicular rash is found in a dermatomal distribution. In advanced cases, multiple dermatomal involvement is seen. Usually, this herpes zoster first episode occurs if the counts drop below 350. Post-herpetic neuralgia is common and treatment is also very tough. Controlling of the pain is tough. You give analgesics, amitriptyline and pregabalin for this. And one more mucocutaneous disease is Kaposi's sarcoma. This is a vascular tumor. It can be seen in the oral cavity or anywhere in the body. While lymphatic spread, it spreads to the viscera. Lungs and GIT are also involved. These lesions, they appear as reddish purple lesions and they easily bleed on touch. And differential diagnosis for this Kaposi's sarcoma is bacillary angiomatosis, which is a bacterial infection caused by Bartonella henslii. Kaposi's sarcoma is due to sexually transmitted human herpes virus 8. Kaposi's sarcoma, they respond to ART. If they're not responding to this, then you give chemotherapy. Chemotherapy can be given along with ART if there are very poor prognostic factors like visceral involvement of Kaposi's sarcomas. This is the image of AIDS patient, oral cavity showing reddish purple lesions of Kaposi's sarcoma, which easily bleed on touch. And this is one more image. I already told you bacillary angiomatosis is one of the differential diagnoses for Kaposi's sarcoma. This is a bacterial infection. These lesions also look like superficial red purple lesions, or they can also present as multiple subcutaneous nodules. These lesions are painful. Diagnosis can be made with biopsy and staining this with Worthen starry silver stain, where you find these aggregates of the bacilli. Doxycycline and azithromycin are effective. In AIDS patients, they have these allergic reactions to insect bites, and this allergic reaction patient presents as intense itchy symmetrical rash over the trunk and extremities, and this intense itchy symmetrical rash is called papular pleuritic eruption. This is also seen in AIDS patients, and these individuals are at 100 times more frequently they present with drug rashes. They present with drug rashes to sulfonamides and NNRTIs, non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Oral conditions, oropharyngeal candidiasis is the most common. It's caused by Candida albicans. Patient presents with white patches inside the oral cavity, and these patches, when they're scraped off, you find some red raw surface. Oral cavity showing oral candidiasis, oral thrush, and this one scrape, they have some red raw surface. This is the image showing oral candidiasis in AIDS patients. And Epstein-Barr virus. This virus can cause enlargement of filiform papillae of the tongue, and it appears as a black hairy tongue. Sometimes the minor aphthous ulcers, in advanced disease, they can become giant aphthous ulcers. These giant aphthous ulcers, they destroy the tissue and they're very painful. And these aphthous ulcers, they look like herpes simplex ulcers. So these aphthous ulcers, which look like herpes ulcers but not herpes ulcers, are called herpetiform oral ulcers. How do you differentiate? You just need to do biopsy to differentiate herpetiform ulcers from herpes simplex ulcers or other CMV ulcers. Histoplasmosis also causes oral ulcers in AIDS patients, and as these patients are at more risk to develop drug-induced rashes, or as a part of Stevens-Johnson syndrome, they can have the superficial oral ulcers. Kaposi's sarcoma, I told you, it can involve any part of the body. They are seen as reddish purple lesions in the oral cavity or all over the body. They can also form ulcers, especially in the hard palate. Gingivitis is common, and nail disorders. AIDS individuals, due to reduced immunity, fungal infections are very common. So fungal infection of the nails, onychomycosis, occurs. And there can be discoloration of the nails in AIDS patients due to virus itself or due to the use ART drugs like ridobutin. Esophageal candidiasis is the most common cause of odynephagia in AIDS patient. Suppose AIDS patient who is truck driver presents to you with odynephagia, that is pain on swallowing, dysphagia and regurgitation, our first GD should be esophageal candidiasis. Concomitant oral candidiasis can be present in about 70% of the patients. They respond well to azoles. Fluconazole 200 mg for 14 days is curative, but you can have these relapses. This is endoscopy of the esophagus showing pseudomembranous candidiasis in AIDS patient. If the patient is not responding to fluconazole, then you should think of other diagnosis, like it can be major aphthous ulcer or CMV ulcers, or it can be herpes simplex esophagitis also. for this biopsy is required. HSV esophagitis, it presents as single solitary large ulcer in the esophagus, which can look like punched out ulcer on esophagoscopy. These patients also present with odynophagia. This is the image of HSV esophagitis showing one solitary punched out ulcer. Diarrhea. Diarrhea is very common presenting problem. Due to this, patient will have severe dehydration. They also have HIV wasting syndrome, severe weight loss. So this is a very common presenting problem in patients with advanced HIV. They can present with either large bowel diarrhea or small bowel diarrhea. How do you differentiate large bowel diarrhea from small? Clinically, large bowel diarrhea, they will be having a quantity of the stool is less. Less watery, less quantity is less, but the frequency is more. It will be more than 5 times per day, and you can have blood and mucus in stools. But small bowel diarrhea, patient passes large amounts of stools, but the frequency is comparatively less. It will be around 3 to 5 times per day. There is no blood and mucus in stool. If at all there is blood, that is altered blood. And positive organisms for large bowel diarrhea is Shigella salmonosis and Campylobacter. If the patient had history of antibiotic usage, then you should think of Clostridium difficile as one of the DDs. If counts are dropping below 100 and if patient is having chronic large bowel symptoms, think of cytomegalovirus, CMV colitis. For this, you need to do colonoscopy, and you can see ulcers usually involving left side of the colon, and if a biopsy is taken, they show typical owl's eye inclusion bodies. Small bowel diarrhea, causative organisms are cryptosporidiosis and Isospora belli. Diagnosis is usually made with stool microscopy with Jaden staining. If the cysts are smaller in size, less than 10 microns, then diagnosis is usually cryptosporidiosis. But if the cysts are bigger in size, then you should think of Isospora belli. If you're not getting diagnosis with stool samples, even with 2 specimens, then you should think of duodenal biopsies. 40% of the patients with disseminated MAC, they have watery diarrheas. This is Cryptosporidium on staining and Isospora belli. Treatment for chronic diarrhea, drug of choice for Cryptosporidium diarrhea is nitazoxanide, and for Isospora belli, it is cotrimoxazole. Cotrimoxazole is used in several opportunistic infections like pneumocystis, PCP pneumonia, toxoplasmosis, and Isospora belli. I told you, if you're not getting diagnosis with stool microscopy, you can go for duodenal biopsy, which confirms the overcyst, the center part consisting of the cysts. Intestinal tuberculosis typically involves ileocecal junction. That's the most common site for intestinal tuberculosis, ileocecal junction, and patient can present with a mass in the right iliac fossa or fever, weight loss, diarrhea. Hepatobiliary diseases, chronic viral hepatitis. HIV co-infection increases the risk of hepatitis B and hepatitis C. Risk factors for all these are almost same. So HIV co-infection increases the risk of hepatitis B and C. As the immunity is lowered in HIV individuals, there will be less elevation of transaminases, liver enzymes. And this increases the risk of liver fibrosis and hepatocellular carcinoma. So HIV co-infection increases hepatitis B viremia and also increases the risk of liver fibrosis and HCC. So in all HIV infected individuals, first, as a baseline, you need to check for hepatitis B virus status. Then when should you start hepatitis B treatment? You should start only when there is active hepatitis B replication, which is indicated by HBeAg positive or HBV DNA more than 2000 international units per ml, or if there's any evidence on biopsy, inflammatory evidence. Hepatitis C treatment should be deferred in patients with C CD4 count less than 200 until they are stable on ART. HIV cholangiopathy, tract can be involved, forming sclerosing cholangitis, secondary sclerosing cholangitis. Symptomatically, symptoms can be relieved in these patients via ERCP. Papillary stenosis is common, and it is amenable to cautery via ERCP. Symptomatic relief is provided. Coming to respiratory disease in AIDS patients, these AIDS patients are at increased risk of developing bacterial pneumonias, TBs, and pneumonias due to pneumocystis jeroeschi, that is PCP pneumonia. Out of all these, patients are at increased risk of developing bacterial pneumonias. There is high risk, and after this, tuberculosis TB is most common than PCP. In AIDS patients, most common diseases which leads the patient to hospital are respiratory diseases, pulmonary diseases. PCP pneumonia, key presenting feature is patient present with progressive dyspnea with a duration of less than 12 weeks. AIDS patient presenting with fever, prolonged history of fever, cough, which is dry cough, that is non-productive cough, and progressive dyspnea, and oxygen saturation is disproportionately low, then and the counts are also less, you should think of PCP pneumonia. How do you diagnose it? Chest X-ray. Chest X-ray in early stages of the disease, it can be normal. In later stages also, there will not be much findings. You can see only bilateral interstitial infiltrates spreading out from the hilar regions. CT is more sensitive than X-ray. This shows typical ground glass interstitial infiltrates, and pneumotor cells can be seen which can rupture to form pneumothorax. So X-ray and CT helps you in diagnosis. This is X-ray of PCP pneumonia patient, AIDS patient, showing bilateral interstitial infiltrates, perihilar infiltrates. The rest of the lung appears to be normal, but the oxygen saturation is disproportionately low in these individuals. Diagnosis is also made with staining of the fluid which is obtained from bronchoalveolar lavage. This fluid is stained with gomori, methanum, and silver stains, and thus this is like fungus can be detected with this staining. Treatment, these patients respond well to cotrimoxazole, but if the patient is severely hypoxic, the saturation SpO2 is less than 90, PaO2 less than 70 or 60, then you should go for systemic corticosteroids. If the patient is allergic to cotrimoxazole, then IV pentamidine can be given. Next, pulmonary tuberculosis. I already told you TB should be considered in every manifestation of AIDS patient. PTB in non-HIV patients is different from HIV patients. In non-HIV individuals, pulmonary tuberculosis usually present in the apical regions of the lung. Apical regions of the lung with cavities is a usual presentation. But in AIDS patients, as the immunity is lowered, cavity formation is less. There will be very small cavities or no cavities. There will be widespread dissemination, and patients presents to you with miliary tuberculosis. And in non-HIV individuals, usually upper lobes of the lungs are involved because they're more aerated. Whereas in HIV individuals, the lower zones of the lungs are involved. And concomitant extrapulmonary pleural involvement is also seen in HIV individuals. They present with pleural effusion and hilar and mediastinal lymphadenopathy. Coming to sputum smears. In HIV individuals, sputum smears can be negative for virus because as there are small cavities, negative for bacteria. This bacilli may not be shed due to smaller cavities. So smears can be negative. This is X-ray of AIDS patient showing miliary tuberculosis. It is seen as multiple spots in bilateral lung fields. I told you most common sites of concomitant extrapulmonary tuberculosis is pleura and lymph nodes. So this acidic bacilli can be found on wider needle aspirates from the nodes than the sputum. Pleural aspirates also shows lymphocytic exudates, and biopsy will confirm the diagnosis, and they respond well to ATT. This is the X-ray of PTB in advanced HIV infection. The lower zones are involved, and there is hilar and mediastinal lymph node enlargement. So TB picture in non-HIV individuals is different from HIV individuals. If there is mild immune suppression, then the X-ray picture will be similar to non-HIV patients' picture. If both TB and HIV are present in patient, how do you start treatment? Will you give ATT first or ART first? ATT should be given first to decrease the bacterial load, and then after about 2 weeks, ART should be started. Why is it so? What happens if we give ART first? If we give ART first, then immunity will be improved in the patient. So there will be increased inflammatory response, increased cytokines, and there will be increased tissue damage. So if patient is presenting to you with certain symptoms and you directly give him ART, there will be worsening of these symptoms. When you are giving treatment, patient should improve, but in spite of treatment, he is worsening. That is, paradoxical worsening is seen due to this increased inflammatory immune response. So there's high chance that patient will drop out. He'll not adhere to the treatment. And sometimes this response can be so severe that you can lose the patient. So you should not take chance. This complete reaction comes under the term IRIS, immune reconstruction inflammatory syndrome. So to prevent this risk of IRIS, you give ATT first and reduce the bacterial load, and then after 2 weeks give ART. ATT, then 2 weeks, and ART. You should remember this is very important. Then if patient is developing IRIS, what will you do? Will you drop stop treatment? No. You continue the treatment, but manage all the other side effects which you are getting. Steroids are helpful in this. Bacterial pneumonias, I told you, more than TB and PCP pneumonia, bacterial pneumonias are 100-fold increased in HIV patients. Streptococcus pneumonia is the most common cause. Treatment is with broad spectrum beta lactams, ceftriaxone and amoxicillin clavulin. This is X-ray in AIDS patient showing pneumococcal pneumonia. It's a consolidation or patch in one lobe of the lungs. There can be other miscellaneous causes of pulmonary infiltrates, pulmonary cryptococcus, coccosis, lymphoid interstitial pneumonitis, Kaposi's sarcoma, etc. There is an entity called as lymphatic interstitial pneumonitis, LIP. In AIDS patients, due to B-cell dysregulation, there is antibody-mediated damage to the lungs. So patients present with dyspnea, and there will be bilateral hazy lung fields, but no organism can be isolated. This is completely antibody-mediated damage. Coming to involvement of central nervous system in the eye, central nervous system and peripheral nervous system can be involved directly by the virus or due to the opportunistic infections. And most of the AIDS patients, they have cognitive impairment or memory loss. They cannot recognize. They have severe cognitive impairment. There is a term called HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders, HANDE. And this term, HANDE, describes a spectrum of disorders. This includes asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment, minor neurocognitive disorder, and severe HIV-associated dementias. Most of the individuals, most of the adults, more than 50% of the adults above 50 years, they're exposed to a virus called as JC virus. But once the immunity drops, this JC virus causes a disease called as progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. That is, it's a progressive disease, and patients present to you with episodes of stroke and also cognitive impairment. This virus, JC virus, it stands for John Cunningham virus. It is named after a patient. Usually all the viruses are named after a doctor, some doctors, but this is a virus named after patient John Cunningham. He's an AIDS patient with Hodgkin's lymphoma. From this patient, this virus was discovered. Vision impairment can occur in PML, that is progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, due to involvement of the occipital cortex. How do you diagnose? MRA helps you in diagnosis and also CSF. On MRA, you can find these characteristic appearances. There'll be enhancing white matter lesions with surrounding edema. Subcortical white matter lesions, usually parietal and the temporal lobes of the brain are involved. And from the CSF, you can isolate the JC virus DNA by PCR. In spite of this, once you come to diagnosis, there's no specific treatment and prognosis is poor despite of ART. CMV encephalitis, patient presents with behavioral disturbances, cognitive impairment and reduced level of consciousness. Focal signs also may occur. Detection is CMV DNA in the CSF. Response to anti-CMV therapy is less. Space occupying lesions. Patients presents over symptoms typically present over days to weeks, and the most common cause is toxoplasmosis. Most common space occupying lesions, toxoplasmosis. Others are CNS lymphomas and tuberculomas. AIDS patient with count CD4 count less than 100 presenting to you with seizure, then first DD you should think of is cerebral toxoplasmosis. This is a space occupying lesion. It is caused due to reactivation of the residual Toxoplasma gondii cyst from the past infection. And imaging, patient on the image you can find multiple lesions, usually involving the basal ganglia area. And these lesions, they have a ring enhancement with eccentric dot sign and perilesional edema. Toxoplasma serology shows evidence of previous exposure, positive IgG antibodies. Imaging multiple, this is MRA brain of AIDS patient with cerebral toxoplasmosis. There are multiple ring enhancing lesions with surrounding edema, which is characteristic. Standard therapy includes sulfadiazine with pyrimethamine with folinic acid to reduce bone marrow suppression risk. Cotrimoxazole can also be used. As it is more equally effective and less toxic, and clinically improvement, that is the seizures, this they can be seizures can be clinically patient can be improved in 1 to 2 weeks, and radiological improvement will be seen in 2 to 4 weeks. This is MRA showing multiple lesions, especially the basal ganglia area is involved with eccentric dots and edema around that lesion. And one more space occupying lesion is primary CNS lymphoma. It is a cancer. It's a high grade B cell lymphoma caused due to Epstein-Barr virus. Diagnosis is with imaging and with CSF. Imaging, it shows a single enhancing periventricular lesion with moderate edema is typical. This is also image of primary CNS lymphoma. Large enhancing mass is present, which is involving the right frontal and the basal ganglia area. There is edema around this, and this explains seizures. CSF also helps in diagnosis. You should check for Epstein-Barr virus DNA by PCR. Brain biopsy is definitive, but it carries a risk of morbidity. Prognosis is poor. MRA, cerebral toxoplasmosis, you find multiple lesions, mostly involving basal ganglia. CNS lymphoma, you find a single lesion. Eccentric dots and ring enhancing sign is seen in toxoplasmosis. Tuberculoma lesions, they resemble toxoplasmosis, but that edema component is less marked, and usually single lesions are seen with tuberculoma. And if you're suspecting it to be tuberculoma, you should check for tuberculosis elsewhere in the body. And the CSF features, they show TB picture, that is glucose levels will be very less and protein is very high and ADA levels are also increased. They respond well to ATT. Stroke. AIDS patients are at high risk for stroke development because there is accelerated atherosclerosis in these individuals. Because there is continuous inflammation in the body as a part of immune response to the HIV virus, though the patient is on ART, there will be some inflammation or continuing in the body. So there is accelerated atherosclerosis. And moreover, the ART drugs, some ART drugs, they cause dyslipidemia. And HIV virus vasculopathy, that is, it can cause vasculitis, which can cause stroke. So if a patient is presenting to you with stroke, HIV individual, you should also think of TB vasculitis and meningovascular syphilis also. Meningitis, if HIV patient is presenting to you with fever, headache, vomiting, decreased level of consciousness, neck stiffness, you should think of meningitis. And cryptococcal meningitis is the most common cause of meningitis in AIDS patients. How do you diagnose it? With the help of CSF. You should check for cryptococcal antigen in the CSF. And this has a very high sensitivity and specificity. So it's important to check CSF cryptococcal antigen test. Imaging, MRI shows soap bubble appearance in cryptococcal meningitis. And CSF, if you stain it with Indian ink, you can find the capsule also. Indian ink preparation. Treatment is with amphotericin B plus flucytosine, if available, for 2 weeks, followed by fluconazole. TB meningitis. Patient present with features of meningitis and CSF picture is consistent with TB picture, and also should check for TB elsewhere in the body, and they respond well to ATT. Prophylactic drugs for PCP pneumonia, which is caused by pneumocystis jerovicii, drug of choice and prevention is cotrimoxazole. And for preventing toxoplasmosis, cotrimoxazole is used. Cotrimoxazole is different from clotrimazole. Clotrimazole is antifungal and cotrimoxazole is a combination of trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole. It's antibacterial. If patient is presenting with encephalitis, toxoplasmosis with encephalitis, then treatment is pyrimethamine, sulfadiazine plus leucovorin. In MAC infections, clarithromycin, ethambutol and rifabutin is given. If patient has tuberculosis bacterium want to test more than 5 mm, then isoniazid with pyridoxine for 9 months. If HIV patient is exposed to chickenpox, then prophylactically you can give varicella zoster immunoglobulins. Fluconazole for cryptococcus and coccidiosis, itraconazole for histoplasmosis and ciprofloxacin for salmonella, doxycycline for Bartonella Hansley, and for CMV retinitis, valcyclovir and acyclovir. Peripheral nerve diseases, HIV infection can cause degeneration of the axon. So due to axonal degeneration, they can be damaged to the peripheral nerve. So patient presents to you with sensory motor peripheral neuropathy. Patient can also present as acute inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy, like they can present as Guillain-Barré syndrome. But this is uncommon. During primary infection, they can present like that. Mononeuritis, single nerve involvement can occur, and patient can present with facial nerve palsy. Cord involvement is seen due to compression from the tubercular spondylitis mostly. Vascular myelopathy is seen in advanced disease of HIV. Psychiatric disease morbidity. Significant morbidity due to psychiatric disease is very common, and it's a major risk for poor adherence to treatment. Reactive depression is the common disorder. Diagnosis is difficult, as many patients have this concomitant HIND, that is HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders. Substance misuse is common in many groups. AIDS patient with CD4 count less than 50 presenting to you with progressive painless loss of vision, then CMV retinitis is the first differential diagnosis. Fundoscopy vitreous will be clear, but there will be hemorrhages and exudates, often sheathing of the vessels. So diagnosis is usually clinical. But if there's any doubt, a vitreous fluid can be taken and CMV DNA by PCR can be demonstrated. Treatment for CMV retinitis is ganciclovir or valganciclovir. Mimickers of CMV retinitis, ocular toxoplasmosis also mimics CMV retinitis. But here, there will not be any retinal hemorrhages. HIV retinopathy, a microangiopathy that causes cotton wool spots, can occur. And varicella zoster infection can also cause vision loss by causing progressive outer retinal necrosis. So what are the vaccines you give for HIV patients? Hepatitis A vaccine, B vaccine, pneumococcal and HPV. What are the CVS manifestations? Patient can present with myocardial infarction, MI, due to accelerated atherosclerosis. And also cardiomyopathy is one of the CVS manifestations. Coming to management of AIDS, you give ART in these patients, antiretroviral therapy. What are the goals? Our goal should to reduce the viral load to undetectable level for as long as possible. There is no specific complete treatment for HIV. You can only prolong the lifespan of the individual. You can only improve the quality of the life. So we should reduce the viral load to undetectable level for as long as possible. And also you should increase the CD4 count. Normal count is 800 to 1200. So you should improve the count at least to over 200 cells so that patient don't get all these opportunistic infections. To improve the quality and quantity of life without unacceptable drug toxicity. And by early initiation of the treatment, you can reduce the mortality to 50%. And also our goal should be to reduce the HIV transmission from individual to individual. So when should we start ART? Earlier, they used to say we should start ART when counts drop below certain levels, when CD4 count drops below certain levels, or when patient is in particular stage of the disease, then you should start ART. But by doing that, there is a high morbidity and mortality. Why should we wait until patient is developing all these opportunistic infections? We should not. So irrespective of the CD4 count or the clinical status, ART should be started in all patients immediately after HIV confirmation. You should not wait for patient to develop all these opportunistic infections, okay? Immediately, you see that HIV is positive, HIV is confirmed in the patient, you start ART, irrespective of the CD4 count. Do not wait for CD4 counts. That is important. Irrespective of the CD4 count or clinical status, ART should be started. By initiating treatment like this earlier, you can reduce morbidity and mortality so much, and also you can reduce the risk of transmission from person to person. This is the image showing HIV replication cycle. What happens when the virus enters into our body? Its main target is CD4 cells. HIV virus enters the body and it attaches itself to the CD4 cells, CD4 receptors, with the GP120. And once it gains access into the cell, inside the cell, HIV RNA, with the help of enzyme reverse transcriptase, it gets converted to DNA. And this DNA, with the help of enzyme, integrates itself with the host human DNA. After integration, all this process of transcription, translation, and occurs, and viral proteins will be produced. And these immature viral proteins, with the help of enzyme protease, they develop into mature forms. So here, three enzymes, reverse transcriptase, integrase, and protease, they help in virus replication and maturation. So our target by using ART should be targeting these enzymes, RIP, RIP. So our drugs, they include reverse transcriptase inhibitors, protease integrase inhibitors, and protease inhibitors. You can also target the virus by preventing its entry and fusion, entry into the cell. They are entry inhibitors and fusion inhibitors. In pharmacology, you must have learned all these drugs names. You need to memorize them. You can keep some codes to memorize them. Entry inhibitors or fusion inhibitors are enfuvirtide and maraviroc. Nucleoside reverse in reverse transcriptase inhibitors, you have two types: nucleoside reverse transcriptase and non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors are tenofovir, edofovir, zidovudine, didanosine, stavudine, emtricitabine, abacavir, and lamivudine. NNRTIs, these they have vir, V-I-R, in the middle of this drug name, you have this letter vir. So like that you can remember. Efavirenz, nevirapine, dapivirine. And protease inhibitors, they end with navir, N-A-V-I-R, darunavir and ritonavir. Integrase inhibitors, dolutegravir and raltegravir. They end with gravirs. How do you choose? Standard combination is you give two NRTIs with an NNRTI, protease inhibitor or integrase inhibitor. Dual NRTI combinations are usually emtricitabine, lamivudine, together with abacavir, tenofovir, or zidovudine. In high income countries, the regimen is dual NRTIs combined with an NNRTI or a protease inhibitor or integrase inhibitor. All these three regimens have similar efficacy. Resistance testing also should be done. For low and middle income countries, WHO recommends NNRTI plus dual NRTIs. And a second line, ritonavir boosted protease inhibitor plus dual NRTIs. NNRTIs are cheaper than PIs, that is protease inhibitors, so they are preferred by WHO as first line and they're better tolerated. I told you in AIDS patients you should treat opportunistic infections, and if TB and HIV are together, first you start ATT, after 2 weeks start ART. If ART is given first, IRIS occurs. That is immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome. This is due to production of cytokines which reset the thermostat of the hypothalamus. So patient will be having fever even after medication. So dropout rates will be high and there will be paradoxical worsening. Management is to continue and to ensure that opportunistic diseases are adequately treated. Steroids are used for more severe iris manifestations. How do you prevent HIV? Preventive measures. Sexual education programs in the school should be conducted, and there should be easy accessibility for voluntary counseling and testing. So there should be VCTC centers, and there should be promotion of safer sex practices like delaying the sexual debut and condom use and fewer sexual partners. Effective ART for HIV infected individuals and pre-exposure prophylaxis for high-risk groups and post-exposure prophylaxis. Parenterally, before blood transmission, all the donors should be, this questionnaire should be done, and routine screening of the donated blood should be done, and injection drug use, education, and needle syringe exchange, all this you should educate the people. Perinatally, antenatal HIV testing should be done, and all the measures should be taken to reduce vertical transmission from mother to child during delivery. Occupational education and training. Universal precautions should be taken. Needle stick injury should be avoided, and post-exposure prophylaxis also should be done. As of date, there is no vaccine available for HIV due to extensive genetic diversity. No vaccine is available. Pre-exposure prophylaxis. There are two prophylaxis: pre-exposure and post-exposure. Pre-exposure prophylaxis is for people at ongoing high risk from sex or injecting drug use. They are ongoing high risk. So for these individuals, you should give pre-exposure prophylaxis. Daily tenofovir plus emtricitabine reduces the risk of HIV acquisition. Post-exposure for people with occupational exposure or even non-occupational exposure, if there are any needle stick injuries, first dose should be given as early as possible, preferably within 6 to 8 hours. There is no point in starting post-exposure prophylaxis after 72 hours. So whenever mostly house surgeons, they're exposed to this needle stick injuries. So whenever you get this needle stick injury, start prophylaxis within 6 hours. Do not delay, because after 72 hours, it's of no use. Tenofovir along with emtricitabine is the most widely used dual NRTI combination together, either with the protease inhibitor or integrase inhibitor. Thank you. Any doubts? Any doubts? You read this topic today itself. All these are new terms, various opportunistic infections. And for treatment part, I didn't tell you side effects of the drugs. Those you read it from pharmacology part. And take home messages. You don't wait for CD4 counts to drop or patient develop severe opportunistic infections. You start treatment immediately. If patient returns HIV positive, immediately start treatment. Don't wait. And also you give ATT first, and then after 2 weeks give ART to prevent iris. And for post-exposure prophylaxis, it's better to take within 6 to 8 hours and do not wait, because after 72 hours, it may not be of much use. And all the opportunistic infections, respiratory disease and CNS diseases, they're more important, because most of the patients get admitted due to respiratory or CNS opportunistic diseases. Okay then, thank you. There are no doubts. Read it today itself so that you can remember. Thank you.